Namaste and welcome to About Stories. This is Shruti. Today, I'm here to introduce you all to an ancient Indian epic named the Panchatantra, which is a collection of fables. Using animals as prominent characters, it conveys human morality. The stories in Panchatantra are not completely independent, but are interwoven and are stories within stories. The author of this ancient book was a great Indian scholar named Vishnu Sharma, and it's believed that the Panchatantra was written before 300 BCE in Sanskrit and has been translated in more than 50 languages worldwide. Over a period of time, the Panchatantra has undergone various minor changes, but the gist remains the same. Our effort is to present the book in its best form for our current generation. So, let's begin the stories from this extraordinary literary work. A long time ago, the kingdom of Pataliputra was ruled by the noble king Sudarshana. He always took great care of his people, and they in turn were also very happy with him. As days passed by in prosperity, King Sudarshana, who like all was getting old and was worried about his three children, whom he felt were incapable of ruling his vast kingdom. They would never listen to the advice of their gurus and were always involved in bringing shame upon their father's reputation. One day, one of King Sudarshana's ministers advised him to seek the help of great scholar Vishnu Sharma. Vishnu Sharma was immediately invited to the courtyard with a great respect and was offered a seat beside the king's throne. King Sudarshana expressed his grief about his sons and wanted Vishnu Sharma to help them become great kings. Vishnu Sharma understood the king's sorrow and promised him, "Oh my great king, there is prosperity and happiness everywhere in your kingdom. I understand that you want your heirs to take care of your kingdom and continue your legacy. Please, don't worry about this, as I promise that I will take them to my ashram and impart the rich knowledge of politics, economics, and moral sciences." The king was very happy to hear this. Immediately, he called his three sons and introduced them to their new guru, Vishnu Sharma. Once at the ashram, upon seeing the beautiful environment, the princes were filled with joy. They said to themselves, "Wow, what an amazing environment. No one will hesitate to study in this beautiful place so close to Mother Nature." Thus began the prince's journey of learning about life and the qualities of being great kings. They learned many things from various books through their guru Vishnu Sharma. The last book was one which taught human morals, and it was called Panchatantra. Panchatantra consists of 5 parts. They are MithraPrapthi, meaning the gaining of friends, MithraPeda, which means the separation of friends, kakolukyam of crows and owls, labdha pranasham, loss of gains, aparikshita karakam, ill-considered actions. Among these, MithraPrapthi is considered to be the most important. MithraPrapthi. As their daily chore, the princes got up early, cleaned their guru's place and were eagerly waiting for him. As their guru Vishnu Sharma arrived, they touched his feet and took his blessings. Impressed by the prince's gesture, Vishnu Sharma said, "My dear students, I'm very happy by your virtues. I'm able to keep up my words given to your father just because of your good deeds. Now, I will start teaching lessons from my book Panchatantra, which will make you learn moral values and will get you going on enlightened path. This in turn will guide you in ruling your kingdom in a wise manner. These will be through stories from the first chapter named MithraPrapthi." Excited by their guru's words, the princess said, "It is our good luck that we got a guru like you who can lead young people like us on the path of prosperity." Vishnu Sharma continued, "This chapter will help you understand that from a common man to a king, if one befriends a good man, they will prosper in all ways. Nonetheless, that friend will protect you in all times. I will tell you a lesson based on this." The story of Chitragreeva. Once upon a time, near a village, there lived a pigeon king named Chitragreeva. He and his crew started searching for food. They flew to a big tree nearby. As they saw grains of rice over there, one of them said, "We are so lucky that we found food without any hard work. Come on, let's enjoy." Chitragreeva immediately said, "My dear friends, do not rush. Listen to me. Try to understand the situation. In this remote area, who will drop grains of rice? This could be a hunter's trap for us. And if we go over there, we could face death." But the pigeon group opposed this by saying, "Oh, come on, Chitragreeva. You always suspect everything. Do not let us loot this food just because of your suspicion. Even if you come or not, we will go and eat the grains." "Please, do not go, my friends, or else we will face the same fate of the man who lost his life for the greed of the gold bracelet. I will tell you that story. Kindly listen," requested Chitragreeva, and continued to tell the story of the gold bracelet. The story of the gold bracelet. There was a traveler who was going to the nearby city via jungle. On the way, a hungry tiger saw him and thought of tricking the traveler to kill him, as he was old with no physical strength. The tiger thought of a plan to attract the traveler by bringing the gold bracelet which he took from another man after killing him. The tiger kept the gold bracelet in its mouth and the traveler got greedy as soon as he saw it. Looking at the traveler, the tiger said, "I see you are a poor man who is in need of money. And as you can see, I have a gold bracelet. I want to give this to you so that I may get rid of my sins and you may get rid of your poverty. The traveler said, "You are a carnivorous animal who can kill anyone. So, what made you so humble to help me? How can I believe a cruel animal like you?" The tiger answered the traveler by saying, "Sir, you can see I'm an old tiger, but when I was young, I killed many people mercilessly. And that's why my sins have increased. My health also failed me over years. A rishi advised me to donate gold to a poor man to get rid of my sins. So, I want to donate this gold bracelet to you. To tell you frankly, I found this bracelet in a pocket of a man whom I killed earlier. Kindly accept my donation," requested the tiger. Believing the tiger, the traveler said that he will take the bracelet. The tiger understood that the traveler completely believed him. This man is killed by his own greed. However, without any hardship, I got my food. Thinking so, the tiger said to the traveler, "As this is a pious deed, I request you to take bath in this pond before accepting my donation." Listening to the seemingly kind words, his own greed made the traveler mad about the gold. He did not even think, how can a cruel animal like a tiger would help him? Without any further thought, he swiftly jumped into the pond. The traveler kept going deeper into it. He eventually got stuck in the quicksand of the pond. He immediately shouted for help. Listening to the traveler's cry, the tiger shouted, "I'm coming for your help." True to the carnivorous nature, he attacked and killed the traveler. Through the story, Chitagriva explained his friends not to fall in a trap like that greedy traveler, but the pigeon group opposed this. Chitagriva tried to caution the group again, but they did not listen. As he was the leader, Chitagriva took the risk on himself and flew under the tree first. Seeing him, all the other pigeons followed. As they settled down, a big net dropped on them. A hunter hiding behind a bush threw another net on them to trap the group in a strong hold. All the pigeons were in shock and felt ashamed as they did not listen to their good friend Chitagriva. Feeling the pain himself, Chitagriva said in an assuring tone, "Listen, friends, don't worry about what has happened. We should use our wit, and if we work as a team, we can save our lives. Before the hunter comes, we should fly at once with this net on us and get help to free ourselves." Amazed by Chitagriva's bright idea, all the pigeons together began their flight at once with the net still on them. Looking at this, the hunter was astonished and was not able to do anything. After flying some distance, as the net was heavy, the pigeons were exhausted. They asked Chitagriva for help again. He then said that he was directing the group near Gandaki River to his friend Hiranyaka, the mouse, who could help and set them free. As the group reached Hiranyaka's place, Chitagriva shouted with pain for his friend's help. Recognizing his friend's voice, Hiranyaka came running to Chitagriva. He saw him in trouble and immediately started to rescue his friend. But Chitagriva asked Hiranyaka to help his group first. Understanding Chitagriva's kind heart, Hiranyaka went on to cut the net
and in no time, they were all free from the clutches of the hunter's net. The pigeon group was very happy. They thanked both Chitagriva and Hiranyaka. All the people feasted before flying away in joy. Mr. Sharma continued, "So my dear students, by this story, I hope you understand how a good friend can help you when your life is in danger. Note that this is not the end of the story. A crow was watching all that was happening to Chitagriva and his friends. The princes were eager to know what happened next and requested Vishnu Sharma to continue the story. The story of the crow and the mouse. As the crow saw the flawless friendship of pigeons and the mouse, it thought that it should also have such a good friend like the mouse Hiranyaka and flew near him. As the crow was landing, its wings produced a lot of noise and blew air in the surroundings. This scared Hiranyaka. "Oh my God, I think an eagle came here and it's better for me to stay inside." Thinking so, the mouse stayed inside the burrow out of fear. Standing at the entrance of the burrow, the crow said, "Oh my dear mouse, come outside. Don't be afraid." Hearing so, the mouse came outside and asked, "Hey, who are you? Why did you call me?" "My name is Lagupatana. I'm a crow. I came here to be your friend. Kindly accept my friendship," requested the crow. "Ha! You are my natural enemy. Believing you will be like the deer which was about to lose its life by trusting the fox. I will tell you that story. It may ring you some bells." Saying so, Hiranyaka started the story of the cunning fox. The story of the cunning fox. Once upon a time, in a dense forest, there used to be a crow and a deer who were best friends. The crow and the deer used to help each other in gathering food. Their friendship was well known around the forest and everyone were happy with them. But there was a fox who was jealous of the crow and the deer's friendship. Moreover, he drools whenever he looks at the hefty deer, as he wanted to kill it and have a feast for himself. As always, the crow accompanied the deer and the fox's sneaky idea did not work. One day, at any cost, he thought of killing the deer. He went near it when the crow was not around and said, "Oh honey, I am overwhelmed to see your friendship with the crow. No one will get a true friend like you. So, I want you to be my friend. Will you be so?" The poor deer believed the fox. The crow came to know about this and warned his friend by saying, "My dear friend, do not listen to the fox. You should know its cunning nature. If you go with the fox, you will be deceived in the same way as the old eagle was deceived. I will tell you the story." Saying so, the crow tried to enlighten his friend. The story of the cunning cat who deceived an old eagle. In a forest, on a branch of a big tree, there used to live an eagle named Manjirika. As he was old and purblind, he was not able to move nor hunt his food. Looking at Manjirika's agony, the rest of the convocation tried to console him by saying, Oh Manjirika, we have been watching you suffering since long. In this age, it's not good for you to strain yourself. Anyhow, we will be hunting for our food and we will be sharing it with you. It's better for you to stay with us, and in return, you can take care of our children when we are away. Manjirika was very happy to hear that and agreed with them. As a daily routine, the birds left for food and Manjirika took charge of their kids. One day, Marjalika, a cat, came by and saw the group of birds leaving the nest. He heard the shriek of the eaglets and became excited. Aha! I will celebrate today. The eagles have left the nest for food. I will get to the top of the tree and eat the eaglets. Thinking so, he started to climb the tree. As Marjalika approached the top, the eaglets started to cry out of fear. Listening to this, Manjirika immediately said, "Who is that? Who climbed this tree? They cannot escape me." "Oh my God, an eagle is guarding this place. I should pretend to be good with it, or else it will kill me." Thinking so, the cat approached Manjirika with respect and said, "Namaskar, Gurudeva. My name is Marjalika. I killed many rats and birds in my life. A hermit said that killing living beings is a sin. Hence, from that day on, I am roaming and looking for an enlightened being like you. My search ends now, as I found you as my guru. I request you to enlighten me with those divine words of yours." Manjirika, unknown of cat's cruel intention, accepted it as his disciple. From that day on, Marjalika daily came to Manjirika. Pretending to be a disciple, he took eaglets and eggs one after another, ate them, and while going home, he threw the feathers and bones in Manjirika's nest. Unknown of this heinous act, blind Manjirika allowed Marjalika to come in daily. As the birds returned to their nest, they were sad to see their little ones vanishing day by day. Out of respect, they did not question Manjirika. All they assumed that some snake might have come and ate their children. As days passed by, the birds were getting intolerant about their vanishing kids. "Who will kill our kids continuously? This could be an insider's job." Thinking so, the birds immediately went to Manjirika's house. They were shocked to see the bones of their children in Manjirika's nest. They immediately came to a conclusion that Manjirika was killing their children. The birds swiftly cornered Manjirika and killed him by poking with their beaks. The crow warned the deer. "It's pity Manjirika lost his life, as he believed the cunning Marjalika. I'm afraid the same could happen to you." But the deer did not listen to his friend's suggestion and continued to move closely with the fox. As days passed by, the fox's anxiety to kill the deer grew. One day, the fox said, "Hey deer, there is a maize crop nearby. You can go and have it without any problem." Listening to the cunning words of the fox, the deer daily went to the maize field and ate until his stomach was full. The vanishing of maize raised an alarm to the farmer. He set a trap to catch the culprit. The next day, unknown of this fact, the deer, as usually, came to eat the maize. But this time, it got caught into the trap. He shouted for help, but the fox, who was nearby, said, "Actually, I'm not in a mood to help you. You better be this way." The fox pretended to leave the place and hid himself behind a rock. It thought, "Aha, the farmer will come in the evening. When he looks at the deer, he will definitely kill it. Thank God, at last my wish is being fulfilled." Looking at the fox act, the deer was in shock. It thought, "Alas, I should have listened to the crow, who warned me about the fox's cunning nature. But now, this friendship is about to cost my life." As it was dusk, the crow was worried about the deer's return and started to search for him. After some time, the crow saw the deer struggling for life in the maize field. He immediately went near it and asked him what has happened. The deer explained how the fox cheated him. The crow immediately came up with an idea and said, "My dear friend, you just stay dead here. I will pretend as if I'm eating you. Looking at this, the farmer will think that you are dead and will remove the net on you. At that time, you swiftly jump and run away." The fox behind the rock did not see the crow coming, as he thought there is time for the sun to set, and slept for some time. As the sun was setting down, the crow started to shout and pretended as if he was eating the deer's eye. Listening to the crow's noise, the fox immediately woke up, looked at the deer and saw it dead. The fox was very happy as he accomplished his desire. It waited for the farmer to remove the trap so that it can eat the carcass. Meanwhile, the farmer came and saw the dead deer. He started to remove the net, and when he completely removed it, the crow shouted and flew away. Seeing it as a sign, the deer in a flash ran away. The farmer was astonished. He was very angry. He immediately threw a crowbar towards the deer to kill it. But the deer narrowly escaped death. At the same time, the farmer heard a cry behind the rock, and he immediately went near it. He saw the crowbar got the fox instead of the deer. The fox died with a lot of pain. Hence, the fox learned a hard lesson as he tried to deceive his own friend. Hiranyaka told Lakpatna, "I may be fooled like the deer who got fooled by the fox. So, I cannot be your friend." This saddened Lakpatna. He spoke to Hiranyaka. "Hiranyaka, what you are seeing is true. I may be your natural enemy, but if I had the intention to kill you, I would have not talked to you this long. Please do not suspect everything and try to understand me. It's not good to reject when a person has offered you friendship." Hiranyaka was pleased by Lakpatna's words and accepted his friendship. Days passed by as the two friends lived happily. They helped each other in all aspects of life. On an evening, Lakpatna said to his friend, "Hiranyaka, I'm not able to find good food in this place. Why can't we go to Dandakaranya? There lives my friend Mandara, a turtle. He will help us find good food and we can live there happily. I want you to come along with me. Due to food scarcity, Laghupatna said they should migrate to a new place. To this, Hiranyaka said, "My dear Laghupatna, I cannot live without you. I will also come with you," said Hiranyaka. Hearing so, Laghupatna was very happy and they both started for Mandara's place. As they reached Mandara's place, Mandara was very happy to see his long-lost friend Laghupatna. He also greeted Hiranyaka and offered a place to live. From then on, the three became very good friends and lived happily. On an evening, as the three friends sat by, Mandara asked Hiranyaka, "Hiranyaka, I never saw a mouse living in a forest. Your species live along humans. How come you ended up here?" Hiranyaka started to tell his story to his friends. History of Hiranyaka. Earlier, near a city, I used to live in a burrow of a chol tree. I made my living by stealing gems, bits of gold and food from others who came there for shelter. I used to steal more than what was needed for me and stored all that in my burrow. One day, Chudakarna, a beggar came for a shelter to the chola tree. He used to beg around, eat what was needed and preserve the rest. I frequently stole his food, for which he always got angry and tried to kill me many times. But my moral never changed. As days passed by, another beggar named Sudhakara joined Chudakarna. They both gathered food by begging and as my chore, I stole their food. Sudhakara saw me stealing and said to Chudakarna, "Brother, did you see that mouse? It's fat and strong. I do not understand how is it so healthy. There could be some strong reason behind this." To his words, Chudakarna said, "Oh, come on, Sudhakara. You always seem to suspect everything and everyone. Take things easy and do not stress yourself about the mouse." Sudhakara said, "There is always a reason for everything, Chudakarna. I will tell you a story to prove this. I hope you will believe me about the philosophy behind every act." Saying so, Sudhakara started the story. The story of hen eating sesame seeds. There was a Brahmin named Shankaraya. He ordered his wife to grind some sesame seeds and make flour out of it for his father's annual ceremony. Obeying her husband's order, the wife washed the sesame seeds and has put them under the sun to dry. While she left for other work, a hen came nearby the sesame seeds and started to eat them. Shankaraya saw this and yelled at his wife, "You imbecile women, come here at once. These sesame seeds have been defiled by the hen and I cannot use them for my father's ceremony. You just give the sesame seeds to the neighbors and bring some new seeds from their home." The wife again obeyed her husband's order and left for the neighbor's house. She asked her neighbor, "Namaste, can you please exchange this washed sun-dried sesame seeds for the ones at your home, as I have no use for these sun-dried sesame seeds now." The neighbor's husband overheard this, got a doubt, called his wife in and said to her, "Don't be a fool. Who will exchange washed, sun-dried and hygienic sesame seeds for the old sesame seeds? There is something which Shankaraya's wife is hiding from us. It's better not to exchange the seeds and say no to her." Listening to her husband, the neighbor's wife replied to Shankaraya's wife that she has no sesame seeds at home. Hence, my dear Churakarna, there is always a reason for every happening. Saying so, Sudhakara and Churakarna followed me secretly to my burrow. As they found my house, they destroyed it using a crowbar, and they were astonished to see my wealth. They immediately took the gems and gold from my house and left the site. Thus, I lost all that was mine and had to roam again in search of food. And so, again I went near the beggars to steal some of their food. Sudhakara saw me. "This mouse will never learn." Thinking so, he suddenly threw a stick on me. I nearly missed it, or else I would have not been alive today. That day, my friends, I thought it's not safe to live there and left the place for the forest. At that time, Chitagriva became my friend. Because of him, Lagupatana too became my best friend. And through them, I met you, Mandara. Living with you guys is my luck. Saying so, Hiranyaka ended his past times. After knowing Hiranyaka's past, Mandara said, "My dear friends, greed is a cause of all miseries in one's life. Being satisfied with what one has is a quality of a noble person, or else one has to face trouble like the greedy fox did." Hiranyaka asked about the greedy fox and Mandara started to tell its story. The story of the greedy fox. In a dense forest, a hunter killed a deer for his family's lunch. Carrying the deer on his shoulder as he was getting out of the forest, unknowingly he thrashed a snake with his foot. The snake, in a dying state, bit the hunter with its poisonous fangs and died. In the forest, the hunter could not find any medicine for the snake's bite. And so, he also lost his life. This way, the deer, the hunter, and the snake were dead. A fox on his way saw the three dead bodies. Looking at the precious food, he was overwhelmed with joy and started to dance like anything. He thought, "Aha, this is my lucky day. I got plenty of food to eat. This would satisfy my hunger for many days. I need not worry for food anymore." After a few minutes of joy, he remembered his hunger and looked at the three corpses. The fox is confused what to eat first, but his greed did not allow him to eat anything. He said to himself, "Is it necessary for me to eat this food now? I will once again search for something small to satisfy my hunger. I will start eating the snake from tomorrow morning, the deer for 10 days, and the man for a month." Saying so, he searched here and there for a small animal. He found the hunter's bow with a string attached to it. He said to himself, I see that this bowstring is made out of an animal's nerve. So, let's eat this for time being. The fox went on to bite the string on one end. As it has tension, it immediately threw the bow onto the fox, only to strike his heart hardly. The fox shouted with pain and died slowly. Hence, my dear Hiranyaka, it's okay to earn wealth, but to store it unnecessarily out of greed is not a good thing. Hiranyaka agreed to Mandara's word and said that he was lucky to have a wise friend like him. Days passed happily as the three friends always stayed together, shared what they could find, cared for each other and were content with their lives. One day, as the three friends sat together, a deer came running towards them. The deer was in terror. Looking at it, the three asked who he was and the reason for his fear. The deer started like this.
Guys, my name is Chitranga. I'm being hunted by a hunter. And so, I need a place to hide. I request you people to help me, begged the deer.
Chitranga, don't worry. No one will come here. You can stay with us until you feel safe, assured Mandara. After a few days, Chitranga also became a good friend to the three. He daily wandered the forest for fruits and quenched his thirst at the river where Mandara lives. The life is going smoothly for Chitranga. As it was like this, one day Chitranga went deep into the forest but did not return to his home. Mandara was worried that his friend did not return. He asked his other two friends and got no proper answer. So he believed that Chitranga might be in trouble.
If so, I will fly, search the whole forest and find Chitranga.
You don't worry, Mandara, said Lagupatina and started to search.
After a while, he saw Chitranga under a hunter's net. He was trapped and couldn't move. Lagupatina flew near Chitranga and asked why is he in this state. Chitranga said,
Brother, there is no time to explain. I request you to go and get Hiranyaka who could help me to get rid of this net.
Lagupatina went for Hiranyaka at lightning speed. He said,
Friends, Chitranga is trapped in a hunter's net. He needs our help badly.
Immediately, Hiranyaka responded,
If so, I will sit on your back. You fly to him and I will rescue Chitranga.
Lagupatina brought Hiranyaka to Chitranga. Hiranyaka swiftly cut the net and rescued his friend from the hunter's trap. As the three were on safe ground, Lagupatina flew away, leaving Chitranga and Hiranyaka to return home. On their way, Hiranyaka asked Chitranga,
How can a wise person like you get into such danger?
We came to rescue in time. The very thought of you being harmed is killing me.
Thank God you are safe, my friend.
What should I say, Hiranyaka? My karma is like this. God has written my fate in a bad way. I've been living a tough life since my childhood, cried Chitranga.
Stop weeping, my friend. Hating yourself does no good to you. Tell me what happened. How did you come to us? What did you do before meeting us? And where did you live? Asked Hiranyaka.
Chitranga started to tell its past to Hiranyaka. History of Chitranga.
When I was born, a hunter killed my mother. From that day on, I faced troubles in every aspect of my life. I missed my mom when I looked at other kids around me playing with their mothers. As it was like this, one day I went deep into the forest with others in search of food. With the other thoughts in my mind, I roamed here and there and got separated from my group. As I walked towards my home, a hunter trapped me and caught me in his net. I was afraid that he will kill me. But later, I said to myself, what's the use of me being alive? At least I will become food to this hunter. To my surprise, the hunter did not kill me, but took me to his home. Aha! What a beautiful deer! Why don't I present this to the king? He will definitely give me some money. Saying so, he presented me to the king. The king was fascinated by my charm and he ordered his workers to present me to the prince. The prince was very happy to keep me as his pet. He did not tie me at one place, but assigned two guards to my care, and he let me roam around within the palace. As I liked the place, I too did not try to escape. Days passed by with joy. The prince trusted me completely and retired the two guards who were guarding me. Now, there was no one to stop me. I got my complete freedom. I roamed the whole gardens, the crops, and ate what I wanted. There was no limit for my happiness. Everyone around there loved me so much that the grief for my lost mother was eased. One day, it was raining heavily in the kingdom. To protect me from getting wet, the prince tied me to a pole near his room. That day, the natural scenic beauty around the king's garden was so captivating that I was not able to hold back myself. I started to dance like anything, but felt sad that I was tied to a pole. I said to myself, "Oh God, what use is this life without enjoying the nature at this wonderful hour? It's my bad luck that I'm born here." The prince heard me and was stunned. How can a deer talk in human language? How is this possible? Saying so, he immediately called the minister and informed about the miracle. The minister said to the prince, "Sir, looking at the way of the deer, we strongly feel that it omens something bad for the kingdom. It's better for us to get rid of the deer by sending it back to the forest." That way, the king's guardians left me in the forest. As I was alone wandering in the forest, a hunter saw me and tried to hunt me down. While I was escaping, unknowingly, I came to you guys. That way, you became my best friends. Meanwhile, as Chitranga finished his story, Lagupatina, who was flying above them, said, "Friends, why are you walking like snails? The hunter is coming this side. I think he came to know about Chitranga's escape." Listening to their friend, Chitranga and Hiranyaka raised their speed to reach home. On the way, they saw Mandara. "Thank God you guys came back. I was worried about your safety. I'm happy that you are fine," said Mandara. "Oh my friend, why did you come here? We guys would have come to you. The hunter is chasing us and he is near."
saying so, the three friends ordered Mandara to rush. Meanwhile, as the hunter approached, Lakpatana flew onto the tree, Hiranyaka ran into a burrow, Chitranga hid himself behind the bushes. But Mandara could not run anywhere as he was a turtle. The hunter saw Mandara and said to himself, "This is my lucky day. I got the turtle even though I lost the deer." He carried the turtle on his shoulder in a net and headed towards his home. As the hunter was going away, the three came out and said to themselves, "Oh God, poor Mandara, who came for us, caught unnecessarily by the hunter." As they thought about rescuing Mandara, Lakpatana came with an idea and said to his friends, "Hiranyaka, you told us a story about the crow, the deer and the fox. Do you remember? Now, me and Chitranga will do the same and you know what you have to do." To implement the plan, Lakpatana said Chitranga that to go faster than the hunter and lay dead on his way. Obeying his friend's order, Chitranga lay dead on the hunter's way. As the hunter was approaching, Lakpatana acted as if he was eating Chitranga's eye. Looking at the scene, "The god is showering his grace upon me. If not, how can the escaped deer lie dead on my way? I will take the deer, peel off its skin, and will give it as a present to the king. I will keep the meat for myself. That way, I will satisfy my hunger and become wealthy. I will think of this turtle at the later time." Thinking so, the hunter kept the net carrying the Mandara on the ground and went for Chitranga. As the hunter kept Mandara down, Hiranyaka at lightning speed came towards the net, cut it down and rescued Mandara. Immediately, Mandara hid himself behind the bushes near him. So did Hiranyaka ran into the burrow. As and when Lakpatana saw his two friends get to safety, he flew away saying, "Cow, cow." Seeing this as an indication, the deer also ran away immediately. All these events happened in fraction of seconds. The hunter understood that he was ridiculed by all these animals together. This is what they call bad omen. Or else, how can I lose all food at once? Thinking so, the hunter left the place. As the hunter was away, Hiranyaka and Mandara came out and reached the lake. These two saw Chitranga and Lakpatana over there. Mandara thanked all his friends for rescuing him. From that day on, the friendship between these people grew strong. This way, we have ended MithraPrapthi. Saying so, Vishu Sharma looked at the princess. "So, my dear princess, what did you learn from these stories?" asked Vishnu Sharma. "Gurudeva, good friends always help each other in all times. Not only that, if a person befriends a good man, that person will be protected in all times. For this, we can consider Mandara, the cunning fox, the innocent deer Chitranga, Hiranyaka and Lakpatana as examples," said the princess. My dear students, you have learned about gaining good friends. Let's stop here today and start tomorrow morning with Mitra Beda. Saying so, Vishnu Sharma left the princess to rest. Friends, as Vishnu Sharma said, MithraPrapthi ends here. Hope you like all our episodes. We are coming soon with another part from Panchatantra. Do not forget to like, share and subscribe to our channel
for upcoming videos. Thank you so much for watching. Take care. Bye. Love you all.